Hi, it's Apidays Helsinki here again, and I'm here with Vlad Stirbu. And Vlad, before I let you loose on RegOps, then please share us your experiences about this remote weird times that we are living now.
Hi, Mariuka. It was an interesting time because, how can I say, I was practicing the remote work already before, but now it was in a way like forced remote work, so not as nice or as in the beginning. But yeah, I think this is the situation. A bit about working equipment at home, so that one had to be adjusted. So, but otherwise, I think this is like my normal.
Yeah, it seems to be that quite a lot of people are actually kind of feeling, or at least the speakers here are actually feeling that this is pretty normal to them, even if it's not so normal to maybe other people. But let's just say that both of our sons, your son and my son, were last year in the physical Apidays Helsinki, and my son just said that he's much more enjoying the back office stuff now than standing there physically for a couple of days. So there's that at least. But hey, so RegOps, you are going to explain to us what that is and how is it related to APIs and software in general.
Yes. Okay, so the talk would be about RegOps, and this is a relatively new technology or methodology to develop software in regulated environments while maintaining agility. And some story about how I ended up here. So before starting CompliancePal, I have been working at Nokia for a long time, and the last part there was involved medical software development. And that was my contact with regulations. And let's say that my computer science PhD alter ego got interested into this side of the business. And when Nokia stopped that activity, I started CompliancePal with the goal of making the development or the software development in regulated environments a bit nicer than what I witnessed. So to start, this is already wide known. So software is eating the world. The quote was made sometime in around 2000. We are seeing that software is actually eating the world. So it is everywhere. So previous places where previous was mostly dominated by hardware with a bit of firmware are nowadays connected to the internet, and they are like always on, and they are transmitting data, and the simply the software footprint increased all over the place. And why is this important is because traditionally the software development has been done according to the waterfall methodology. So this was the first software development practice that emerged in the 1970s, even before. And in that world, everything is very well planned. The phases are going in a well-defined sequence. The plans are very comprehensive, but the structure is very rigid. So it is very difficult to change anything while the development has started. And the software industry at large noticed this. So the shortcomings of waterfall development. And around 2001, we witnessed the emergence or like the adoption of Agile at large. And this was in a way like moving completely in the opposite direction. So Agile is based on four tenets, and what it values is like ability to change versus like well-defined plans or following like deep specifications. So emphasis is on running software, communication with customers or with other teams, and teams are flexible to choose their own tools and define their own way of working. And this is in a way quite opposite to waterfall, and because of this flexibility, Agile was considered for a long time like inappropriate for developing regulated software. Around 2016, maybe even early, DevOps emerged as a way to formalize practices that allow software teams to automate deployments, tests, and that was taken also the world by storm. And nowadays we have what I'm call DevOps plus plus, where other activities have been integrated into DevOps. So generating documentation out of code, security, so DevSecOps, and so on. But so overall, there is a journey that traditional manufacturers have taken from waterfall to agile and towards DevOps. And then also the new entrants into the regulated space, they started from agile, they didn't have the legacy of waterfall, and they are moving slowly into the DevOps and DevOps++. So why is this important? Is because in the medical, traditionally the medical field, or especially in the medical field, the products there have been seen or regarded as reliable. They had a very long life. They are obviously regulated, so they have to be developed according to very well-defined processes. And then they are mainly consisting of hardware that is delivered to hospitals or somewhere where professionals are using. But new trends, and this is the consumer side, so something that was considered traditionally like a consumer devices, they started to get more and more into the medical space, and they are or the traits in this cluster of are dominated by design. They are disposable, considering the long lifespan, so a couple of years comparing to tens of years for the traditional medical. They are developed according to Agile, and they consist mostly of software, even if there are cases where hardware is present. And one of the prime examples of such a device is the Apple Watch. So it was an accessory to the phone, but due to its ability to collect biometric data about its user, it is used extensively in the medical field. So how agile is relevant into the discussion about regulation is, so we are looking at modern agile, and here we have the methodology most used, the Scrum. So it all the product is developed, or the requirements are in the product backlog, and then with every iteration that can last from 2 to 4 weeks, can be shorter, can be longer, the team commits to a sprint backlog, and during the sprint it is implemented, and at the end of the sprint you have a product increment that can be released to consumers or to the users. So in Agile, is not uncommon to have a very lax approach to documentation, going all the way to simply saying like documentation is not a real work. So whenever documentation comes into the picture, developers are finding more excuses to find reasons to spend with other tasks that they have during the daily activity. And everything is like fine, so it looks fine. The features are implemented at a fast pace, but the reality hits the wall when the product is ready to be released to the market, and we are seeing the CE mark here. And that's the moment when the panic typically sets in. So the awareness of the regulation becomes like visible, and people are starting to ask questions. What does this CE marking means actually? And if we are talking about medical space, we mean legislation. So all the products that are allowed to enter the European market, they need to be compliant with the legislation. And the legislation currently is the Medical Device Directive. And from next year, the Medical Device Regulation will come into force. It was delayed for 1 year due to the coronavirus situation. And the legislation is meant to be long time, is not intended for developers or technical people. So in practical terms, the legislation is converted into a set or distilled into a set of activities and practices that are defined in the ISO standard organization or ICE. And they refer to the quality management, so the ability to deliver consistent results, risk management, so the ability to evaluate the risks to the patient, to the practitioner that is using a service or a device, and then the ability or the processes that are used by a manufacturer to develop the actual software. And if we look at the software development lifecycle, we see that, okay, the section 5 is the one that defines what are the activities or what are the steps that a manufacturer of a medical device must take. So they have to have a software development plan. They have to analyze the requirements. They need to have an architectural design for the software, a detailed design of the software, unit implementation and verification, and then integration of the developed software, system testing, and then software release. And for the changes to the system, to the software, we have another flow, which is all the clauses starting with 6. So you need to have a software maintenance plan and a problem and modification analysis steps. Then the modification implementation is the same as when the software is developed originally. So even at this step, we can see that the way the standard is written and it is organized, the clauses are organized, they imply in a way that the software cannot be done in an agile way because we have two steps. One is for the development and the other one is for the maintenance. But this can be folded quite easily into an agile work because in an agile setup, the maintenance or changes are practically the same as the original development, but it happens in short increments. So instead of having one process during the entire life cycle of the product, we have shorter cycles that are aligned with the sprints. So the contact with these standards is, let's say, overwhelming. So they are written in a language that is not typically familiar to developers, and this is something that causes a lot of friction. And if we look at the medical software development life cycle, we can see that based on the risk classification or the safety classification of each software, and the standard defines three of the three such classes. So class A, the product doesn't cause any harm to the patient. Class B, minor harm or injuries can occur during due to the its use, or class C, severe injuries or even death. So the manufacturer has to perform quite many of these tasks. And if we take into consideration that the medical device regulation that takes into effect in 1 year takes as the baseline, or so all the software has are now class B, as opposed to before where they were class A. So there are quite many activities that a manufacturer has to integrate into their software development plan. And if we look at this diagram here on the right hand side, so we see that all these like five and six become relevant. So except the red dots, so there are a lot of activities that needs to be done, and this can be overwhelming, and especially for organizations that haven't been exposed before software governed by regulations. So what is the response to this is that, okay, they are still following the Scrum, but in order to fulfill the regulations or to be compliant to the regulations, so there is a new component or a new sprint that is included. So on a fixed configuration of the product, the documentation sprint starts, and the team looks at all the artifacts that have been created during the normal sprint. So requirements, wikis, commits, configurations, tests, containers, deployments. So these are just a subset, there might be others. So they look at this and they create the documentation that is required for the regulators. And then the product is there. So the fixed configuration plus the documentation. The problem is that, I like this quote, is like, do you think that the change is now faster than ever before? So we are looking at the wrong way. So the future is like, the change will never again be as slow as it is today. And why is this important? Is because the complexity of the software changes so much. So we have more code iterations, the teams grows, even products are developed beyond like one Scrum. So there are multitude of programming languages, configurations related to cloud cloud environments, even the programming languages. So how all this is deployed. So the way to do a documentation sprint is like not appropriate, because like this poor hamster, there is no way to escape from that. So what are we going to do? It's like we look at automated medical software compliance. So this is like how things should be addressed. And with this approach, the developers will be able to develop the software and maintain cadence. So this is what they want to do. These are the activities that make them like feel good about their work. Then the compliance officer can focus on what regulatory activities needs to happen in the context of the software that has been developed, and mapping this to FDA or European regulations, and then to this ISO and IEC standards. And then bridging the gap that existed before between software developers and compliance officers is left to tooling. So cores, bookkeeping, enforcing workflows, quality gatekeepers, traceability, and how to generate reports on demand. This is left to tooling, no more humans involved there. And if we look at how a software team works, they already have in place a mechanism in which everybody involved in the software development is involved. So it is it was originated in Git by Git or promoted initially by GitHub. So the pull request we are talking about. So whenever you have a new software or a new feature to the software, a branch is created from the common baseline and the software is developed. When the developers consider that the feature is implemented, a pull request is opened, and then the code review running test happens during the review period. More developers than the original are involved in the review. And then the quality gate is that, okay, all the code is reviewed, the tests are passing, maybe integration tests, some deployments to staging environments. So the code is ready to merge. And this is the flow. To bring the regulate or to bring compliance people into this, we don't have to invent something new. So the review is open or is like opened enough so that we can bring more people into the process. And this is what is happening. This is what CompliancePal is doing in this space. So you expand the review period to include the regulatory review. And we will look, so the quality gate is still there, and at the, it includes also a check that the regulatory activities required for exactly this branch or exactly the software feature are fulfilled and the code is ready to merge. So the pull request is the quality gate that is familiar for the entire team. It also brings visibility there and it allows discussing changes. And in this particular regard, so the medical software or what CompliancePal does, so we bring into this discussion architecture evolution. So it is a lightweight approach to define or to document how the architecture evolves. It is based on C4 model. So it is used also outside this domain too. So there is some familiarity among architects there. Then a very important aspect when developing medical software is dependencies. So we want, you have to evaluate all the dependencies because they haven't been, or most likely they haven't been developed according to the standard life cycle that is required. And then the third aspect is safety classification. So in order to be able to know, or the tools to know what kind of activities they have to check, you need to have the safety classification, and this is integrated here. And we can see that the example here that we have two checks that are failing and the code cannot be merged. And then when these checks are passing, we can merge the code and the button becomes green. In terms of like how this should be organized, and this is a schematic of how CompliancePal does it, is that the developers and the architects are working as usual. So how they are used to do their work. So you develop using Visual Code, Visual Studio Code. You push the commits to Git, and then you have CompliancePal gets notifications that new changes are coming. It analyzes. CompliancePal is able to analyze JavaScript, TypeScript, and Python automatically, so their dependencies. And if anything comes is relevant, it is brought to the attention of the compliance officers, which can decide how how to go about it. And then you have this like larger items needs to be addressed. You open them in the backlog. So all this experience is seamless. It integrates with the tools that they all these people they know how to use. So this is like the answer to what RegOps means. So by following this approach, you are able to integrate regulations into the DevOps cycle. So you end up with regulatory operations extending the DevOps activities. So what would be the benefits of using this? So we have the developers that can focus on what they find interesting. So it takes away the routine. So they have to act only when they need to act. And it frees time to do interesting stuff, rewarding, so implementing features. This is what is happening in practice. And for compliance officers, we get better visibility. So they see what changes occur in the software. And because they don't have to poll all the time to ask people, they have increased capacity so they can focus on their own stuff. And then this propagates like bubbles upwards that you have improved quality. So there is a reduced incidence of errors or surprises because of because the processes are automated. You end up with so fewer errors and increased capacity to deliver the features. So APIs, this is like, because it's an API conference, it is important here to mention that the regulations require APIs or software components to be documented. That means that whenever you are using a library, you need to have an SDK, or if the software component is accessible over the network, you need to have an API or documentation for API. This is quite important, and sometimes the developers or the people involved in the software development, they are not even aware that such aspects exist, and this brings again like visibility, awareness, and links to other activities, so that regulations are not done only for the sake of regulators, but they bring value to the developers, to the compliance, and to the business itself. So this was the presentation. If you have any questions, you can send them to this email address. You can check like what we do here. And I think that we can have some questions now.
Thank you, Vlad. And it's a little bit pressing with the time, so only maybe one short question. So what about API compliance as a thing? So what would you say about that? It can be many things, but...
It can be, yes, exactly. It can be many things. And I think that, so from like strictly medical perspective, you need to have them documented. But this is like a very low bar, yeah? Like just to have documentation for them. There are other industries where APIs are very like, there are more tougher regulations. So banking, the PSD2. PSD2. And then because we are in Europe, GDPR is also relevant. So all APIs exchange data. Of course. Or of most of them exchange data. Yeah. Some of them are for control, yeah. And that data might contain personal information, and it would be wise to identify it also using this kind of iterative approach, so that you are able to document other aspects of the software at the time when the changes happen. So. Regulations, be aware of them. They are a big part of the business environment. Non-compliance can be punished quite harshly. So it is very good to be aware ahead of the going to market rather than after, because the after things are much, much difficult to fix.
Exactly. But hey, you have to be careful of a lot of things. Like in a Finnish summer situation, like I am here now, we have to be aware of bees, because one just flew in during your talk. So this is a very summary way to be risk-free, and let's conclude here, and let's go into the interesting other IoT industries in the next talks. Thank you, Vlad.
Thank you.